Steve, I just got a weird email. Did you buy us airline tickets?
Oh, shoot. It was supposed to be a surprise. I wanted to thank you for letting me live here all this time, so I'm treating the family to a vacation.
Steve, you're so sweet.
Thanks, Uncle Steve.
Best uncle ever.
Look out, world. The Smith family is going to Paris.
Yeah! Rick, I don't like glowing rocks in the kitchen trash.
Well, I don't like your unemployed jeans and my grandchildren, Jerry, but life is made of little concessions.
You know what?
You're going to land on your feet, Jer. Some company out there is going to think they're lucky stars they hired my little brother.
Who the f*** are you?
My goofy brother, Steve? He's been living here almost a year now. Are you losing your mind?
Hey, someone's been spending too much time around glowing rocks, am I right?
Oh, my God!
Everybody just relax for a second. There's no such thing as an Uncle Steve. That is an alien parasite.
But I've known him my whole life.
No, you haven't, Jerry. These telepathic little bastards, they embed themselves in memories, and then they use those to multiply and spread out and take over planets. It's disgusting.
Steve wasn't real?
He's a real piece of shit. This is a big one. Somebody probably tracked it in last week on the bottom of their shoe or on a piece of alien fruit.
Someone?
Get off the high road, Summer. We all got pink eye because you won't stop texting on the toilet.
But Uncle Steve taught me how to ride a bike.
No, Steve put that memory in your brain so we could live in your house, eat your food, and multiply. We could be infested with these things, so we gotta keep an eye out for any zany, wacky characters that pop up.
Ooh-wee! Whatever you want, Rick, we're here to help.
Thanks, Mr. Poopy Butthole. I always could count on you.
Okay, here we are to look at the problem of skepticism. So, this is a classic problem in traditional epistemology. Remember, epistemology is just a fancy word for the study of knowledge. It's one of the main areas of academic philosophy, and again, it's focused on the studying the nature of knowledge, truth, belief, justification of belief, rationality, and so forth. So things that have to do with our knowledge claims, right? So very basic question in epistemology is just, what is knowledge? And how is knowledge possible, if it's possible at all, which is where our problem of our challenge of skepticism comes in. So let's take a look real quickly at that basic problem. So the challenge of skepticism, here's a way of positing that problem, comes from Dancy's Introduction to Contemporary Epistemology. And he says, "You do not know that you are not a brain, suspended in a vat full of liquid in a laboratory and wired to a computer which is feeding you your current experiences under the control of some ingenious technician. For if you were such a brain, then provided that the scientist is successful, nothing in your experience could possibly reveal that you were, for your experience is ex hypothesis, identical with that of something which is not a brain in a vat. Since you only have your own experience to appeal to, and that experience is the same in either situation, nothing can reveal to you which situation is the actual one. Ex hypothesis just means from the hypothesis, right? So there's a kind of hypothetical sci-fi way of positing the challenge of skepticism. Do you even know, right? Is it even possible to know whether you're a brain in a vat being fed experiences, or if you're in the real world having those experiences? Is it possible to know which of those scenarios is the case, right? So here's a way of positing that problem. Another, you know, non-sci-fi way of formulating the issue. So because any knowledge claim that we might make will seemingly be susceptible to error and doubt, it looks like it's possible that we could always be wrong or be mistaken. It's always possible that we could be mistaken about the truth of our beliefs. So, but if knowledge then requires certainty, the kind of certainty that would rule out the possibility of believing falsely or lucky guesses counting as knowledge, then it looks like we don't possess knowledge. So on the one hand, we have the intuition that we know at least some things, but on the other hand, it looks like if knowledge requires certainty and we never have certainty because our beliefs are always susceptible to doubt, then it's not possible to have knowledge. So it looks like, you know, we've got another contradiction here based on our intuitions. So that gives rise to a problem, right? Both of those propositions, we possess knowledge or we have some knowledge and we do not have any knowledge, those can't both be true at the same time in the same respect. So it's the problem of skepticism, right? The denial, and obviously people might mean different things by this term, and so let's kind of clarify which is the relevant sense to us. Some people might use skepticism just kind of as ordinary incredulity, right? So that's how the term might be used sometimes. A non-committal attitude towards something, exercising doubt about something. Let's call that the weak sense of skepticism, just the doubting of the truth of some claim, right? Then there's a stronger sense of the term that denies the possibility of knowledge, either altogether or just in some particular area of inquiry, right? So suppose someone thinks that it's possible to have scientific knowledge, but it's not possible to have moral knowledge. They would be a moral skeptic, but they wouldn't be a complete or a global skeptic because they're saying that some types of knowledge are possible. So again, a couple of distinctions to keep in mind there. And then when philosophers talk about knowledge, they usually have a couple of different things in mind, or it's at least important to distinguish between these different senses of knowledge. Most of the time, an epistemology is really just focused on propositional knowledge or knowing that, as opposed to acquaintance or competence knowledge. So acquaintance knowledge is like being familiar with something. You know whether your pet is anxious or whether they're a very calm pet because of your familiarity with them. Know-how is like competence. It's like techne, being able to accomplish something. What steps have to be taken in order to, you know, erect a house or build a computer. And then again, there's propositional knowledge, which is usually talked about in terms of knowing that something is the case, right? So, and again, epistemology is really focused on propositional knowledge. So how could we have propositional knowledge of the external world, for example, or moral knowledge that's propositional knowledge? So this leads us then to the standard account, or what we'll call the standard account of propositional knowledge, also sometimes called justified true belief. And we've got three criteria here for something to count as knowledge. So, again, not an argument here, but just three criteria. First, we have some agent, some subject that believes a proposition. And belief for us doesn't really mean like affirming a value here or valuing something individually, but the mental acceptance of the truth of a proposition, right? So not just, it's just an epistemic position here, not a moral one in terms of valuation. So sometimes people will say, I don't believe in X, Y, or Z, where what they really mean is they think that it's wrong or that they don't value that particular thing. But what we mean here is just, you know, belief in the sense of whether something's true or not. And then justification, we're worried about, you know, the evidence or the reason given to support the belief. And so that proposition, we've got the agent, first criteria, some agent has to believe the proposition has to be true, and then that agent has to be, or that subject has to be justified in believing P. And so justification here is, you know, epistemic justification. What reason or evidence supports the truth of this other proposition that we're affirming here? And then the question comes in at the third criteria, because how much justification is required? Many people have the intuition here, and we'll use this as our working intuition to start with, that justification requires certainty, all right? So that would mean that knowledge requires certainty. You couldn't be wrong. The justification has to be indubitable then. It can't be open to error or doubt, right? So I have to meet that strong sense of knowledge with certainty then. So one philosopher that was very interested in epistemology and is often talked about is, you know, one of the fathers of modern philosophy is René Descartes. He was very interested in the deductive certainty that modern science seemed to provide and that modern mathematics provided. And Descartes set out on his project to find a proposition that, you know, could serve as the foundation for an entire theory of knowledge. He noticed that people often said that they were certain, but went wrong, or their beliefs turned out to be mistaken. And so he set out to try to erect and establish some body of knowledge by identifying a proposition that he could know for certain, and then deduce other propositions. If you deduce them correctly, then you can know these other propositions with certainty as well. And so this is why Descartes is often called a foundationalist, because he set out on his project of methodological doubt, of doubting everything that could reasonably be doubted till he could find some proposition that he couldn't doubt and that he could know clearly and distinctly, to use his phrase, and then use that proposition as the foundation for the rest of his theory of knowledge, or the rest of the body of knowledge, actually. So Descartes, often called a rationalist, and he engaged in methodological doubt. Again, the project of doubting everything that he could doubt in order to find something that was indubitable, right, beyond doubt. And as a part of this project, Descartes, he entertained some arguments for skepticism. And so let's take a look at two of those. These come from Meditations on First Philosophy. And so we'll call this the dream argument, and then the evil demon hypothesis argument, or the evil demon argument. And again, these come out of Descartes' Meditations. So here's the first passage. He says, "I certainly look upon this paper with eyes wide awake. The head which I now move is not asleep. I extend this hand consciously with express purpose and perceive it. The occurrences in sleep are not so distinct as all this, but I can't forget at other times I've been deceived in sleep by similar illusions, and attentively considering those cases, I perceive so clearly that there exist no certain marks by which the state of waking can ever be distinguished from sleep, that I feel greatly astonished, and in amazement I almost persuade myself that I am sleeping now." So the idea of this passage is that there are times when we're confused about whether we are awake or asleep, and there doesn't seem to be any definitive marker to distinguish between waking states and dreaming states, because some of those times that we seem to be dreaming seem so real to us, as if they are non-dream states but waking states. And so we can turn this into a little bit of a basic argument for skepticism, using that criteria that having knowledge would require us to be able to distinguish whether we're asleep or awake or not, and to know which was the case in order to have knowledge, right? So let's formulate this as just a basic one-stage little argument here. So first, if we have any knowledge, then it must be possible to distinguish definitively between waking states and dreaming states. It's not possible to definitively distinguish between waking states and dreaming states. Thus, we do not have knowledge. So a little modus tollens form argument there. The only question, so it's a valid form. Our question is then, is it sound or not? So that's the first argument, the dream argument for skepticism. Now let's take a look at another one. Let's call this the evil demon hypothesis and the evil demon hypothesis argument. So Descartes goes on, he doubts the difference between waking states and dreaming states, but then he also doubts God's existence and posits this scenario where an evil genius is manipulating our sense experience of the world. So he says, "And yet firmly implanted in my mind is the long-standing opinion that there is an omnipotent God who made me the kind of creature that I am. How do I know that he has not brought it about, that there is no earth, no sky, no extended thing, no shape, no size, no place, while at the same time ensuring that all things appear to exist just as they do now? What is more, just as I consider that others sometimes go astray in cases where they think they have the utmost perfect knowledge, how do I know that God has not brought it about that I too go wrong every time I add 2 and 3 or count the sides of a square, or in some even simpler if that's imaginable. So he goes from extended things, things that have bodies and exist in, space, take up a location, and then he goes to abstract ideas like the square. So he says, "But perhaps God would not have allowed me to be deceived in this way, since he's said to be supremely good. I'll suppose, therefore, that not God, who is supremely good and the source of all truth, but rather some malicious demon of the utmost power and cunning, has employed all his energies in order to deceive me. I suppose, therefore, that whatever things I see are illusions. I believe that none of the things in my lying memory represents to have happened did so." And then he goes on, "I have no sense of the external world, no extension, no shape. These are all fictions, right? So what then is true? So again, drawing on this hypothesis that it's possible there's this demon manipulating our sense experience of the world, and if that's the case, then if we could rule that out, then we could have knowledge. Let's use that as the basis of an argument. Again, let's call this the evil demon hypothesis argument, or just the evil demon argument. And again, we have, if we have any knowledge, then it's possible to rule out the evil demon hypothesis. It is not possible to rule out the evil demon hypothesis. Thus, we do not have any knowledge. Right? So again, another modus ponens argument. You could do these as modus ponens. You can make disjunctive syllogisms here as well. These are just the basic ways I chose to reconstruct them. So there we have two arguments for skepticism, right? And again, they're formulated in as valid deductive arguments, but the question is, are they in fact sound? Do they have all true premises? Well, Descartes, after doubting all these things, thinks that he identifies a proposition that he can know with certainty, or clearly and distinctly, as he says it. So here's another famous passage from Descartes. He's got this famous phrase, cogito ergo sum, which you may have even heard of before, that means I think, therefore I am. So he says, there possibly is, I know not what being who is possessed at once of the highest and deepest cunning, who is constantly employing all his ingenuity in deceiving me. Doubtless then I exist, since I am deceived. And let him deceive me as he may, he can never bring it about that I am nothing, so long as I shall be conscious that I am something. So that it must indeed be maintained, all things being maturely and carefully considered, that this proposition, cogito ergo sum, I think therefore I am, or I exist, is necessarily true each time it's expressed by me or conceived in my mind. So that's Descartes' famous phrase. Now notice what he's saying here is that, look, even if I am being deceived by evil genius, it can't be the case that I'm confused about whether I exist or not. In order to be deceived, I have to first exist. In order to be confused or to doubt or to not know the difference between a waking state and a dreaming state, I would still first have to exist in order to be deceived in those ways, right? So Descartes thinks he's got an argument against the dream and the evil demon argument here, right? So again, we got a criticism from Descartes there of those two previous arguments. What you ought to do is spend some time thinking about how this cogito passage challenges specific components of those of the dream argument and the evil demon argument. So sit and spend some time thinking about how the cogito, Descartes' cogito, which of those premises in those two previous arguments does he most directly challenge with the cogito? And then, so I've already mentioned that the cogito is one objection to skepticism or complete skepticism here. Another thing we might worry about is whether this argument is self-contradictory. If it's the case that we have no knowledge, for example, so assume for the sake of argument the truth of skepticism, then we couldn't know whether the premises in those arguments for skepticism are true or not. So again, maybe there's a self-defeating problem there. And then Descartes, he tries to work knowledge of the external world back into his picture, his body of knowledge, based on the cogito. So he says, how do I know that this wax that is melting as I sit by the fire is the same wax after it changes shape? So he says, consider this wax. It just has been extracted from the honeycomb. It retains some of the smell of the flowers which it has gathered. Its color, shape, size are manifest. It is hard, cold, and easily handled. It gives a sound if you rap it with your knuckle. In fact, it has all the properties that seem to be needed for knowing a body with the utmost distinctness. So he can know that this wax is out there, right? But while I say this, this wax is put by the fire. It loses the remains of its flavor, the fragrance evaporates, the color changes, the shape is lost, the size increases, it becomes fluid and hot, it can hardly be handled, and it no longer gives a sound if you wrap it. Is it the same wax, is the same wax still there? So we go from the hard wax to the melted wax? How do I know it's the same wax after it's changed properties in all those different ways? This is what makes Descartes a rationalist, is he thinks that we know that through pure reason, not just through sense experience like the empiricists claim. Descartes a rationalist. He says that genuine knowledge has to be rooted in innate ideas in the mind. So he says, we must confess that it remains. None would judge otherwise. What then did I know so distinctly as this piece of wax? It could certainly be nothing of all that the senses brought to me. So he's denying that genuine knowledge comes from sense experience there. Since all these things fall under taste, smell, sight, touch, hearing, are found to be changed, and yet the same wax remains. Perhaps it was what I now think, that this wax was not the sweetness of honey, nor the agreeable scent of flowers, nor the particular whiteness, nor that figure, nor that sound, but simply a body, right, a corporeal extended thing, which a little while before appeared to me as perceptible under those forms, and which is now perceptible under others. But what precisely is it that I imagine when I form such conceptions? Let us attentively consider this, and abstracting from all that does not belong to the wax, let us see what remains. Certainly nothing remains except a certain extended thing which is flexible and movable. We must then grant that I could not even understand through the imagination that this piece of wax is, and that it is my mind alone which perceives it. So scholars are a little bit more sympathetic with Descartes' criticisms of the evil demon and skepticism and the dream arguments for skepticism. But they're less sympathetic with his attempt to build external knowledge back in based on the cogito, because couldn't it be still open to doubt that my perceptions actually match what's external to my own mind? So the stuff that I'm perceiving, it seems like there's a gap there which allows for doubt rather than certainty. And since Descartes is presupposing that certainty requirement for knowledge, it looks like he gets himself into trouble there. So some questions. Given our working assumption that knowledge requires certainty, does the wax example really establish knowledge of the external world? Right, as I was just mentioning. Further, does that mean that that something could be mistaken about the certainty requirement, right? That maybe the certainty requirement is off. In other words, if the implication of a particular theory of knowledge implies skeptical paradoxes, then doesn't it show that something's mistaken about that theory of knowledge? So should we really expect any knowledge claim to meet the certainty requirement, or is that just like the highest level of knowledge and we should admit standards of justification that are less than certain? So, for example, we've studied inductive reasoning rather than just deductive reasoning. So maybe we should admit high probabilities into our definition of knowledge and justification there. So again, why accept the certainty requirement? That's kind of the question to leave you with here. Picking up on that, let's look at John Hospers, who is a philosopher that challenged skepticism, and he points out a few things here that we should take into account here. So let's just look at it. It's from an article called Against Skepticism. John Hospers was actually a candidate for president many years ago. He also holds a PhD in philosophy, and he challenges this sense of doubt or the sense of knowledge that seems to be at work in the skeptical scenario. So he says, in daily life, we say that we know that heavier than objects fall, that snow is white. If someone denies this and they can no fact is cited by which the disputant suffices to convince the other, we may well suspect that a verbal issue is involved. In this case, that we're operating on two different meanings of know, because they construe the third requirement, the evidence requirement, differently. So maybe what's going on here is that, you know, we're equivocating different meanings of knowledge here. And then he gives this example of a bookcase where in one scenario he says there's a bookcase in his office and he leaves, and then in another scenario, you know, things were changed around but he didn't have access to that. So he says the difference in the criterion between the two disputants begins to emerge. one of us, I'm using know in the weak sense, in which I know a proposition when I believe it, have good reason for believing it, and it is true. So notice those are the three requirements, but certainty is not a part of the justification. It's just we have a good reason to believe it. But the skeptic is using know in the more demanding sense. He's using it in the strong sense, which requires that in order to know a proposition, it must be true, it must be believed, and we have to have absolutely conclusive evidence in favor of it. So, certainty. And Hospers goes on. It's in this weak sense that we use the word know in daily life. When I know that I have a heart, that if I let go of this piece of chalk, it will fall, the sun will rise, and so on. I have excellent reason or evidence to believe all these things. Evidence so strong, so we say, it amounts to certainty. And yet there are events that could conceivably occur in which if they did occur, would cast doubt on those beliefs or even show them to be false. But the skeptic is, again, relying on that infallibility standard, the certainty standard. The skeptic, Jack Crumley is another philosopher. He picks up on this same point. He's actually Crumley II. He says, the skeptic might then argue along the following line. Suppose we take knowledge of our own mental states as the model of what it is to have knowledge. Because our knowledge of our own mental states is always certain, then any knowledge must similarly be infallible. And so what the skeptic is asking us to do, and this is Crumley's next point, is that we have to rule out these logically possible but fantastical scenarios in order to claim that we have knowledge in the ordinary sense, right? So the skeptic thus claims that we must be able to show that we can rule out competing scenarios, dream, evil demon, in which we would have the very same yet false beliefs. But what is meant by show in this sort of case? What's meant by no, I believe it's supposed to say there. It seems to mean that a person could provide or articulate reasons that could explain why the competing scenario cannot be correct. But then in our ordinary intuitions don't really fit with that. Our ordinary intuitions, Crumley says, are just that, intuitions confined to the sorts of cases of knowledge, whether there is a test, the assumption that there could not be justified unless we rule out conflicting accounts of the data depends on our view that some further evidence can be brought to bear. Namely, why should I entertain the evil demon hypothesis? Yeah, it's a logical possibility, but why should I think that's actually the case in order to have to claim that I'm justified in knowing that, say, there's a lamp in the room that I'm in right now as I record this video lecture? So Crumley says it's not at all clear that we're committed to that assumption, where there simply is no possibility of that assumption holding. And so he says, look, what this shows is that, yeah, sometimes we can rule out alternative cases, but that doesn't mean we have to be able to rule them out in all scenarios in order to have knowledge, right? So what this is driving at is that maybe we should admit, knowledge with high probabilities rather than just as knowledge, propositions that have high probabilities rather than just certainty or that more stringent requirement of certainty. And so then here are four basic criteria for knowing something without certainty. Looks like the absolute certainty requirement for justification is always going to lead us to skeptical scenarios. Skepticism of that sort looks like it's self-defeating, so it looks like maybe we ought to, again, admit justifications that are less than certain. It doesn't mean they could have zero probability and count as knowledge. They have to have high probabilities and count as knowledge. So again, some criteria here for knowing something without certainty. First, if new information contradicts well-established claims that have already been, confirmed beyond a reasonable doubt, then there's good reason to doubt the new claim, to claim that it doesn't count as knowledge. The more justified beliefs the new belief contradicts, then the more reason we have to doubt the truth of the new belief. And then we should proportion our confidence or our belief to the evidence, right? We don't want to engage in wishful thinking or dogmatism or unreasonable standards, right? Notice that some of those could tie back into epistemic vices that we've talked about. And then lastly, if you're personally unsure of what the evidence is, then consult some credible source, right? Some reputable source, that's some trustworthy source to help you determine whether or not you should affirm the belief or not. And so that wraps up a little bit of a lecture on the classic problem of skepticism. Again, it's a standard kind of thing to cover in an intro to philosophy class where we're dealing with classical epistemology here, right? So again, much of epistemology is kind of focused on trying to meet the skeptical standard, and here we have a couple of attempts at doing that. All right, y'all have a good one, and I'll talk to you all in the next lecture.